We are here at City Hall for a regular Community Redevelopment Agency meeting. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Amen. Roll call, please.
Board Member Shuham.
Here.
Board Member Anderson.
Here.
Board Member Kalari.
Here.
Vice Chair Gruber.
Here.
Board Member Biederman.
Here.
Board Member Quintana.
Here.
Chair Levy.
Here. All right. Any conflict disclosures today? Hearing none, let's move on to 9 a.m. citizens' comments. Then we'll run through our consent agenda, regular agenda, informational reports, and comments. Let's begin with Kat Uden, followed by Elena Hershey, Bob Glickman, and then Jenny Wenschel. Morning, Kat.
Morning. All right, good morning. Thank you again for Commission the Community. It was really nice to be able to have that opportunity after so long, and it's important because, you know, we have our meetings at 9 a.m., 1 p.m., citizen comments at 5 p.m. sharp. It's really difficult for residents to be able to get here. We're one of, I think, only two cities in all of Broward County that has city meetings during the day when people can't attend. Obviously, that's not preferable, so having that opportunity to have Commission in the Community is really important, and hopefully next time all the residents who signed up to speak will be able to speak. It was only 17 people, I think, in a two-hour program, considering that we don't give them an opportunity like the rest of the year to be able to do that. To be able to give them that opportunity to speak is preferable. I was told that we could always send an email if you're not at Commission the Community. So I've been sending emails, but some of them have not been answered, so I'm just going to read it in person. Mayor Levy, since you are not in attendance at Commission the Community, we were told that we can email you our questions. This is a message posted by you in 2020 regarding the land use amendment for Emerald Hills Golf Course. You said that you would not vote to change the existing open space recreational land use limitation unless the community decided to support it. The statement read, as mayor, it is important for me that you know that unless, until you, the community, tell me that A, there has been an open and transparent public participation process facilitated by the owner of Emerald Hills Golf Course, where B, there is resulting consensus on a plan which preserves the 18 holes of golf and which the community finds compatible for the protection and enhancement of the surrounding neighborhood per the above city and county criteria, including mitigation through provision of publicly accessible parks and open space to serve the surrounding neighborhood, I will not support any land use change or development proposal for the Emerald Hills Golf Course. The existing open space recreation land use limitation should remain as it is unless the community decides to support and tell us otherwise per the above. So I'm wondering if the same courtesy will be extended to the Orange Brook community for their golf course open space and the Beach community for their 1301 open space. Will you support the 1301 land use amendment if the Beach community doesn't support it? Or is this courtesy only extended to the Emerald Hills neighborhood? Is there favoritism between communities, or will you treat all communities equally when it comes to open space recreation land use amendments? And I know you probably won't answer now, but you're welcome to call me to discuss or email me back and reply. I think that Commission the Community is really important. I hope you continue to do that on a quarterly basis and allow people to speak. Thank you.
All right. Let's go to Elena Hershey, Hollywood Beach Business Association. Good morning, Elena.
Good morning. Good morning, Chair. Good morning, Vice Chair and board members. Elena Hershey, on behalf of the Hollywood Beach Business Association, we would like to express our sincere gratitude to Mayor Josh Levy and our city staff, Hollywood Police and Beach Police, and our community, of course, in assisting with catching the troubled youth, and your professionalism and diligence in doing so. As a citizen, I would comment that it goes to show that we need to, as a community, we need to do a better job and working harder with the upbringing of our underprivileged children, and as a community and businesses, support the local organizations that are passionate about our children, our education and children, their mental health and professional development. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Elena. Bob Glickman, followed by Jenny Wenschel, and I think we have Emilio here. Yep, Emilio.
Good morning, Bob Glickman. As we did the pledge this morning, it reminds me that yesterday, January 6th, was 79 years from D-Day, 1944, where we had 160,000 Allied troops, U.S., Canadian, and British troops, storm the beaches of Normandy. Let's segue into what happened here on Hollywood Beach a little bit. I'd like to thank our police department for apprehending these gun violence thugs for what happened over Memorial Weekend. It's apparent to those of us that live on the beach, I don't know about the rest of the dais or the community, that the beach is becoming overwhelmed with people. There's just too many people there. We have 20,000 people that live on the beach. If you look at some of the pictures, there was 35 to 40,000 people on Memorial Weekend. You have another 15,000 people in hotels. There's almost 70,000 people on the beach. If you had a police force of 5,000 people, they couldn't contain what's going on. You need to figure out a way to hold everybody a little bit accountable and stop the influx of people coming to the beach. Some of the ideas may be to raise some of the parking rates. We haven't looked at this ordinance, the beach residential parking ordinance, since 2019. It never came back before the commission. We have no parking here. You have all these people coming and taking up all the spaces. I understand the beach is for everybody. That's great, but what about the people that live here? It's for us too. You know, maybe we need to consider postponing 4th of July and moving it someplace else in the city, unless you have a plan in place where you're able to contain all of these people. I have a couple of suggestions for you. Okay, we did it in years past. Let's close off some of the beach entrances so we have people just going to the beach in certain areas. I got to tell you, the Nevada garage that you all spent double the money on, $13 million, that garage is empty most of the time. If you go down and look at the Garfield garage, the lot is full. You have this one here, 295 spots are empty on a Sunday afternoon. You need to drive people to the garage. You can shake your head no, but I'm there, I see it. I can see the counter, it's right out there. You know, let's stop backpacks on the beach, let's stop coolers on the beach. You know, we need to somehow contain what's going on here. I also know that you're looking to redo the Hollywood Boulevard Bridge. Let's redo the Sheridan Bridge. Let's put a flyover there. You know, the bridge is closing down again for another 3 weeks, and this is just absolutely ridiculous. You know, we're being impacted by this, and, you know, nobody seems to know what's going on, or nobody seems to care. I want to talk to you about the A1A sidewalks again. I've sent email after email. They are not ADA compliant, okay? You have electrical boxes in there. You have light poles in there. You do not meet the criteria for that, and you need to meet the criteria for those that need it.
Thanks, Bob. Thanks. Appreciate all your suggestions, always. Jenny Wenschel, Sea Turtle Advocate. Welcome, Jenny.
Good morning. I lowered this down.
Sorry that we interrupted your day in the water today for you being here.
You know, I got up to go diving this morning, and I went, oh, my God, there's a CRA meeting, 9 o'clock. I can't go. So I'm going to have to go later on with that. Good morning, CRA board and staff. My name is Jenny Wenschel. I'm a resident of Hollywood. I'm a scuba diver and a sea turtle advocate because the sea turtles do need a voice. A short history lesson. Dr. Kurt Rosenko, the sea turtle lighting consultant hired when the broadwalk lights were being considered, in his report, the potential impact of the Hollywood Broadwalk redevelopment project lighting plan on sea turtles, dated March 23, 2004. In the report, he noted historical photographs provided by Richard Sala of the City of Hollywood Community Redevelopment Association shows the tri-globe incandescent fixtures were a part of Hollywood Beach 75 years ago. At that time, there was no knowledge of the negative impact these lights would have on the local environment and nesting sea turtles. Today, it is known how excess lighting on the beach is detrimental to sea turtle adults and hatchlings. It seems a bad idea to reproduce a mistake made 75 years ago. I find history to be an important tool for learning and feel that history is best served when we learn from our mistakes. I cannot recommend the tri-globe fixture for use on the beach with any light short of a candle. He then concluded, and please note that this was in 2004 before LED lighting and some of the newer technologies were available, the tri-globe fixtures should not be used on the beach. 150 watts of high-pressure sodium every 80 feet will reflect too much light onto the beach, even with shields. I believe the photometrics show that 50 watts high-pressure sodium internally shield from acorn fixtures on the east side of the broadwalk only every 80 to 100 feet would provide enough light needed without rendering the beach a loss to nesting sea turtles. That was 19 years ago. 19 years ago, it was discussed, presented, voted upon, and implemented non-compliant sea turtle lighting. Fast forward, people have sent me photos of bags over the lights. This is in the past week. People are putting bags over the lights. I'm assuming it's CRA, I'm not sure who. And I think this is excellent, and it's a good start. But then they also sent me photos of lights that are in the arches. And according to these photos, those don't look very sea turtle friendly. And those lights spill out on the beach. And there's also lights now in that little wall that are spilling out on the beach. So where we fix in one place, we're making a mess in another. And then, as I was preparing to speak today, I looked over the agenda and saw that number 8 refers to replacing light poles on the beach. It took some digging and realized they are side streets.
Thanks, Jenny.
Can I speak on that later?
Yeah, I think George mentioned that he... George mentioned that you may speak afterwards as well.
Okay,
thanks. All right, Emilio, come on up. Another beach resident. Yeah. How's it going?
Good. Emilio Benitez, 3400 North Surf Road, 38-year resident of Hollywood Beach. Bienvenida, Señora Quintana. It's about time we have another Latino on the commission. I wasn't going to speak on the lighting stuff, but since the name Richard Sala came up, sort of jarred me because I was on that committee. I was the chair of the citywide master plan. We had selected as a committee a different type of lighting, but the mayor at the time didn't like it. So she wanted the lighting that she had at her home in Emerald Hills. Now she turns out to be my neighbor. So ironic as that may be. I appreciate what the CRA is doing. I know I love Susan. She and I talk a lot when she's around walking the neighborhood. And George, I have a great relationship with him. But I think we do need to do something about the lighting. I saw that they did some of the shadowing again, but it's not enough. We really have to focus on that. The ones that we had picked 20 years ago were the ones that are on North Beach Park. Maybe we should consider that, lower the voltage as it was suggested. But I'm here really to talk about the Memorial Day shooting. This has been something that I've been voicing for years now. We've made mistakes. I don't blame anybody on this day. You weren't here. But 20 years ago, when we were talking about Margaritaville, not even 20 years, 15 years ago, when we were talking about Margaritaville, when we were talking about the redevelopment at Charno Park, we talked about creating a substation for the police. It is absolutely essential. The CRA, our taxes are earmarked, and part of the increase in funding for the police comes from that. It doesn't come from the general coffers. I think we really have to address the issue of a substation. I think you all should direct the city attorney to discuss with the city attorney in Miami Beach most of those rules and regulations that Miami Beach adopted have already been vetted through court. No question, there's a civil rights argument and civil liberties argument and all that. But I think it's important to learn from the other communities. I lived on Fort Lauderdale Beach when spring break was an issue, and that was addressed. I think we need to collaborate with our sister cities on those things. Thank you.
Thank you, Emilio. All right, thank you everyone that came to speak at Citizen Comments. Next on our agenda is the consent agenda. Today's items are 5 through 8. We've got 2 items on minutes. The item regarding microtransit services is not consent here, but it's subject to approval at the City Commission and discussion later on this afternoon. So whether or not you have feelings on that item, just realize even if we approve this on consent, it'll be up for discussion at City Commission and requires approval there. And then, of course, a purchase order regarding the light poles. So is there a motion or any comment cards on 5 through 8 on consent?
No, I'll pull number 8 if it's okay, just so that we, because I know the resident wanted to speak on it.
Okay. All right. If there's a motion then.
Motion to approve.
Oh, we have a motion to approve 5 through 7.
Yes.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
I'm sorry?
Aye.
Eight we're going to take up now. Thanks. So let me introduce item number 8 real quick. It's a resolution of the CRA approving the CRA to issue a purchase order to Burkhart Construction for the pole replacement within the Beach District in an amount not to exceed $230,000. George, I'll extend to you a courtesy to describe the scope of this project, and then I'll turn it over to Board Member Caleri and then the public speaker.
Yeah, this particular element is not related to the turtle lighting. I was going to update the board on the sea turtle lighting effort that we're already underway with under the monthly report. This is actually replacing 11 poles and fixing 15 that are in disrepair. There's structural issues. There's just decay overall. And so it includes taking out the existing pole that's damaged, replacing it, and in some cases, the fixture may be damaged as well. So it's really just maintenance of existing facilities. Again, the update I had planned to do under the monthly report, but if you'd like to do it now, we certainly can. Now, I should point out that I know that Jimmy Seda is, and he's item 9, and he wanted to make sure that we get through his item.
He's online?
He's actually here, but he's got a
I don't want to go through all the turtle lighting now, because this item is specific to the pole replacement.
Right.
And we're going to get to the turtle lighting
exactly
during your informational report.
Yes.
So I'll turn it over to Commissioner Caleri on this pole replacement.
So just out of curiosity and forgive my naiveness, but the mention of the lighting in North Sun in the park. Yeah, I guess it's Ann Colbar and North Beach. There's different type of lighting, and I know we are focused on uniformity. If we're replacing those current structures now, what's the difference between that north lighting that was mentioned and the ones that are there?
I am not familiar with the lighting at Ann Cole, but I can tell you that.
Or at North Central Park, they said it's different.
The treatment that we're doing to the globes has been signed off on by Fish and Wildlife and DEP. I think I mentioned here previously that we actually had an on-site visit at, it was like 9 o'clock on a Sunday, and we did a light reading on the seaward side of the pole and had a reading of 0.
Okay. So then the new poles that are going in, time expectant that they'll be implemented, like when will that start?
Well, the board asked us to focus on the existing nest locations.
No, I'm not talking about the sea turtles. I'm talking about this item and the lighting, the fixtures going in.
But again, this is not related to the...
I understand that. I'm asking, when are those lights going in? Like, when will this start
globes,
once we approve it?
The globes will probably be all in place within the next, 4 to 6 months?
Four to six months?
Now, that's the 300 and some odd globes that
before
are
the next
entirely on the broadwalk. What we are focused on is addressing the 14 sea turtle nest locations where we can change out the globe and put in the blocked globe that has no spillage at all toward the water. And that's really the emergency. That And I've just told Tony before this meeting, if we need to pay overtime, if we need to bring in additional labor, whatever it takes, we're going to get that done as quickly as possible. And again, we have a presentation that Francisco has put together to give the board exactly where we stand as of today. And Tony may even have further updates, more current than even the presentation.
So going back to my original question, the 14 poles that we're talking about on item number 8, you said 4 to 6 months before it's implemented?
No, this will be done much quicker. This is 11 poles, but there are 15 that need addressing. Susan, if you'd like to elaborate.
Good morning, Commissioner Kalari. The item that is in item number 8 are poles that are on the east-west streets that were part of the original poles back in 2007 that were ordered from that original company in Canada. So these are ones on the east-west street that were identified that had deteriorated. And so those are the ones that are being replaced as part of item number 8, just the poles and fixtures.
Okay, and when do we expect to see that, 4 to 6 months?
No, I think as soon as the item is approved, the order will go in, and I would say probably within 60 to 90 days maximum.
Okay. And those are the same company that put the original ones in, correct?
No, or is it this is a new company. This company, the original company was a company that had gone out of business called Skycast. This company that supplies these poles, it's called Stresscrete. They're out of Alabama, and they have a lifetime warranty.
That's where I was getting at. It had nothing to do with the sea turtle aspect, just making sure that we have that on a timeline, get them done, and move forward. Motion to approve.
All right, we have a motion to approve the pole replacement and a second from Board Member Anderson. Jenny, did you want to speak on this, the side street pole issue?
Go ahead,
please. And then he's going to address the sea turtles.
Yes. So as I was preparing to speak today and I saw that this came up, I saw that it was on the side streets. And the only thing that really I want to comment about is the size of the lamps are 70 watt high pressure sodium. We have all this new technology out there to make it sea turtle friendly. I realize there's side streets and it's not the actual broadwalk, but we need to start somewhere. And let's make these test cases. Let's see if we can put in the new technology, make it sea turtle friendly. Those lights do contribute to the overall glow on the beach. It would be very, very important to eventually have the whole beach sea turtle friendly. Oh my gosh, it'd be so beautiful walking out there at night like that. And really that's all I have to say is really please consider the actual lights that are going in there. The high pressure sodiums are about the worst you can put in. So thank you.
Susan, could you address LED versus the high pressure and then we'll take a vote real quick?
Yes.
We are undergoing a citywide conversion.
Yes, so for phase 4, the 17 streets that those lights that will be installed as part of phase 4, they have LED amber lights, okay? That was approved for phase 4. The lights on the east-west streets were approved at the time with 50 watt high pressure sodium and the same full cutoff type of fixture, so it looks like a bell. It's a full cutoff fixture, it has internal shields. In terms of converting those, we have spoken to Norelsco about that. What we need to do is we're planning on doing photometrics on those streets and seeing if we change those over to amber LEDs, what that would mean in terms of adding additional poles, to get the right photometrics, because we have vehicular lighting we have to accommodate as well as pedestrian. That study has just started. It's going to take a while, and if we find that it's something, well, basically, we're going to have to come back to you as and have you as the board evaluate, because it would be a capital project.
For the conversion of CRA district lighting to LED?
The 33 streets that we already did, in not just converting it to LED, but to try to convert it to LED amber. And so, as I said, if there are 6 poles per street now, and we have a 1 foot candle average, in other words, just as an example. So if we change out each light for an amber LED light, we don't think we're going to get the exact same reading, So we're going to see what we would need to do to get the reading that we need to, if we're going to convert, not just to convert to the same type of light, but to convert to an LED amber light.
Right.
So
right.
That's, we're in the process. We've just started. I mean, we have to do photometrics, but we'll come back to you. It'll be a capital project.
Yeah. I guess I think the main takeaway here is that these new poles, the structural poles that are being installed, are not going to prevent us from being able to choose and select an LED bulb when the time comes.
Correct.
Right. All right. I see my my panel is lit up here. Let's go with Board Member Shuham.
That was my question. I think I don't want to put words in Jenny's mouth, but her question as well. If we're putting new poles in now, why can't they just be installed LED amber from the get-go? Is it because it's part of a streetscape that has other poles that aren't being replaced? Or do we have a situation in this new purchase order where we have an entire street that we could look at as a test case?
So to answer the first question, we're not replacing all the lights on one street. These are spread out over several east-west streets. And then basically for the second question, as I mentioned, we can't just switch out one light for another, especially when we're going to an LED. To get the right light spread and photometrics, we have to look at either an entire street on its own, or really we would like to look at all 33 streets.
Okay, and just to confirm what the mayor just asked, if we put in these new poles, the light bulb can be switched. It's not like we have to reconfigure the entire thing. If we decide that the LED amber is acceptable with respect to the appropriate required photometrics, we don't need to do a whole big fit out. We can just change a bulb.
We don't know that yet. We might need to add an additional pole. Okay.
Right, but I mean the poles that we're buying, we can just change the bulb.
Correct.
Okay. Right.
On the existing ones, we could change them. What we might need to do to meet photometrics is potentially add another pole.
Got it. Thank you.
All right. Let's go to Board Member Coleri, then Biederman.
So can you explain that again? So you're saying that you'd have to add an additional pole to meet the lighting?
We might need to, because the LED amber, like a 50-watt LED amber, doesn't have the same light distribution as the 50-watt high-pressure sodium light. So to meet the same foot candles on the street for cars and for pedestrians, we might need to add another pole or potentially look into putting a double head on the pole. We don't know that yet.
So you're saying add another pole to provide the proper lighting for safety?
Yes.
Okay, not to replace it. Okay,
correct.
So that's good. That was going to lead me into the question. So while I guess the bigger question, and obviously it's the hot topic, and not to disregard sea turtle and friendliness and so forth, as far as safety and CCTV issues with that amber lighting, has there been any input as to the safety factor for residents and for visitors with the, you know, versus the lighting that we have now versus the amber lighting? Has there been...
That needs to be part of the conversation.
That
absolutely
needs to
that's,
be a
that's
major
been the
part
delicate
of the
balance,
conversation,
frankly.
Because it is a delicate balance.
Absolutely.
And while I am an advocate for sea turtles as well, safety for the two-legged individuals that are sitting in this room obviously is super important as well. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't want to protect one and not the other. And so that's going to be the balance, I think, that we're all challenged with. And I would like to see some type of feedback on the amber lighting and the quality of the CCTV cameras to make sure that human life is protected.
I think that's one of the reasons why the globe masking is such a great option, because it focuses the light onto the broadwalk and, again, zero reading on the shoreline. So
I know we have given that push
to
get that done, and you're going to update us when it's going to be done.
Yes.
I won't burden it any further, but we're all interested in knowing that.
Absolutely.
And most importantly, keeping everyone safe, including the turtles. Thank you.
I think, George, Board Member Coleri's point, I think with the times that we have, we need to also get PD into the conversation of the wedding.
Oh, yeah, and they have.
Don't do it in a silo.
No.
Thanks.
Absolutely.
Board Member Biederman?
No, so, I mean, I agree we can't compromise safety, but if we're spending money, why are we going to waste money on sodium bulbs and fixtures? Because it's not just pulling out a sodium bulb and putting in a LED bulb. It's a whole fixture that has to be changed out. So we're going to, you know, we're doing what other people have said we're doing. You know, we fix it today and we're fixing it again in 6 months instead of thinking ahead. So either we postpone this project, unless it's extremely critical to replace these poles, or we ask Burkhart, since they're here, what the upgrade is to do an LED fixture instead of a sodium fixture.
Well, I think what we have a system that has been evaluated to determine safety and other factors.
I understand that, but they didn't determine safety when they were when FPL went and switched out their poles for LED. That wasn't every pole on a street because it was mixed in with city poles. So some poles were switched and some poles weren't. And it didn't. We didn't take photometrics into the consideration at that point. Now we're going back and we're changing city lights. And then we're going to figure out if we have to put poles in at certain sections. So does that mean that the beach is more important than the rest of the city when it comes to proper lighting for safety?
I mean,
that's what we're saying here.
I think
God forbid we don't have enough light on the beach when we have other people criticizing for having too much light on the beach.
Well, I mean, you have the resources of the CRA, which has been assigned to eradicate slum and blight. We have a system that's been put in that was evaluated for safety, for impact to environment, et cetera. As we transition toward LED, we need to determine what has to be done, whether it be additional poles or maybe increasing the intensity on an LED fixture. Those are all, that's part of the analysis. You can't just randomly say, well, we're going to switch over.
George, let me say this. Let me help here.
Okay.
Obviously, the board members want adequate safety lighting. We also, right. you know, appreciate, you know, the, you know, our, what we do, you know, for turtle, mm-hmm. and complying with turtle lighting. We're talking here about the side streets. There is a sensitivity from beach residents to have adequate safety lighting. I hear that from people. Why is sure. it so dark on the broadwalk, Josh?
Right.
There should be a sign that says, oh, it's because of the sea turtles. Oh, well, if there was a sign, mm-hmm. I would have known. Sorry to ask you. I just felt unsafe. Right. So we need, obviously, to address the lighting on the side streets. The poles have to be replaced because they're a danger.
Correct.
But my point is that, Susan, between now and 60 to 90 days, you mentioned that the poles are replaced. I think the photometric, you know, evaluation of a LED fixture could be done in that time. I don't expect that takes too long a time to test out some bulbs and do some measurements of foot candles. To Board Member Biederman's point of maybe we can resolve that question in advance and maybe not have to put in the, if we find a suitable LED, you know, bulb, that we do that at the get-go instead of the sodium halide, and that's it. I mean, that's... Can you make that, try to evaluate that in advance of the completion?
Yes.
Simple enough.
I just don't understand, and I don't want to, you know, beat it, but why we are approving the purchase of the sodium halogen lamps, or whatever you want to call them, sodium lamps.
This is more about the poles than it is about the lamps.
Right.
Yeah, but on the top of the pole is a fixture. I mean, we're
But I think
fixtures are included in this price, right? They're not using the old fixture.
Susan?
It's a new pole, new fixture.
When we talk about the fixture, we're talking about the bell-shaped full cutoff fixture. We're not talking about the light bulb. So
yeah, but it's not the same fixture that holds an LED bulb that holds a sodium bulb.
But I think what we, and Susan mentioned this, we can go to a double light fixture on what would otherwise be just a single light fixture as we convert to LED.
But Amber. The problem is, because it's a CRA and because we have a large budget, spend it now, and if we have to change it in 6 months, we'll change it in 6 months. That's the criticism from the public. So let's avoid that criticism by trying to do it right the first time instead of, you know, it's always easier to do it right the first time than it is to redo it. Is that what they say or something like that?
Well, we can begin the analysis, as you're suggesting, that totally makes sense, to figure out what would have to be done.
I'm sure Burkhart would like to redo it in 6 months. I mean, that's just not prudent, though.
Right, right.
So, George, at the next CRA board meeting, why don't you, after you've reviewed this question, why don't you give us an update? Susan?
If we need to do the photometrics, we'll start with one block. If it's just a matter of switching out the high-pressure sodium for an LED bulb, we can work on doing that. However, what we would like to do is be able to switch it out to an LED amber light. That's the ultimate goal, because that would meet the current, you know, desire of fish and wildlife. However, to just switch it out from high-pressure sodium to the comparable light output and photometrics for safety, bulb for bulb, that could be done.
Right.
I just don't understand why we're so concerned with photometrics here, but not, I mean, I get it. Get rid of slum and blight. I'm not looking to reduce the importance of that impact, but I just don't see it. I mean, how much is the difference in the head between a sodium high pressure head and an LED head? I mean, I think that's what we have to consider.
Is it the same?
It's the same fixture.
No, it's not the same fixture.
Well, why don't we do this, since staff is not really prepared?
Is Burkhardt here?
I don't know if Adam, are you aware of the
somebody here that
questions?
Can answer this question?
I think that's a confusion, is that they think that there's some big retrofit that would have to happen.
Right. It is
if you
a
wanted
retrofit.
To go to LED.
Adam, can you speak to this? And if you don't know, say that you don't know.
Yeah, so some of the current proposal is correct. We're swapping out the pole, the arm, and then the fixture that hangs on the arm. Part of what is happening on some of the older poles, as they've identified, is they're like the tops are literally blowing off. I mean, you know, some of them have been hit by trucks, so they're not even there anymore. So part of this is just literally putting a new pole in its place so that you don't have something blowing apart on the sidewalk or whatever. Having said that, yes, we can ask the manufacturer if there's an LED light for that, you know, that would fit on that arm. And again, this is replacing exactly what is there now on all of those side streets. But so again, it's the pole, you have the arm that comes down, and then the fixture is hanging. So we can ask the manufacturer about that. I don't know. We'd have to ask.
The challenge is that they're spread out. They're not in, like, you know.
It doesn't matter.
George, I think the gist of the matter is that we want to have confidence that the fixture that we're putting in is universal enough, with the expectation that one day, if we want to change it out to an LED or an LED amber,
yes,
that, you know, as we know, common threading of light bulbs in our homes,
right,
you know,
right,
they make universal adapting kits to bring LED to any kind of standard receiver. Now, if this manufacturer has a receiver type that's unique to sodium halide and is not compatible, then that would beg the question of maybe finding a different fixture so that it is, you know, plug and play, so to speak. We don't want to get married to a restricted fixture that then has to be completely replaced, to Commissioner Biederman's point.
But it's not just that. It's the disposal of the sodium bulbs also is bad for our environment. So we are going to take, 11 sodium bulbs that we're not going to need. We're just going to throw them out in 6 months or a year when we decide to go to LED. So why don't we just go to LED now? We reduce the manufacturing of a sodium bulb by 11.
Yeah.
And we reduce the landfill by 11 bulbs. I mean, I know it's just a minuscule drop in a bucket, but it's setting an example.
No, I think he's right. I think we should approve this with that, provided that the bulbs are LED. Not necessarily right now specify which type of LED, but just knowing that we're going to be doing a retrofit with Noresco for all of these fixtures anyway. Maybe you're going to use the Noresco type fixture that would have come from the broader project. I think that's an endeavor that we ought to pursue. So,
how long have these poles been inoperable?
I don't know. I'm not.
Somebody? Who identified these 11 poles
Tony
and said
may
they're
know.
Inoperable?
I believe Tony's in the audience.
Okay, so another 3 or 4 months aren't going to kill us to make the right decision.
So look, we have a motion to approve the item. There's a suggestion of an
amendment. I'll make an amendment. A motion to approve the item with it being compatible with LED lighting, the fixture. And now that may delay the process.
Second.
But that's what we need.
And I think while triggering the analysis required to completely convert to LED throughout.
So let's take a vote on the amendment to require that the fixtures be outfitted with LED lamps. All those in favor?
Can the amendment remove the wording sodium from the purchase and just have it LED? And if they have to change it and they can come up with a compelling argument why it has to be sodium, they can bring it back in a month.
That's fine.
But I think
that's
we should fine. Approve it based on that's it fine. Being an LED pole.
All right.
Yep.
Yep. Yeah. All right, so the amendment is
actually, it said compatible with LED. We got to be really careful. So careful.
Replacing sodium halide
with, yes.
With LED bulb.
Okay, these so LED I amend heads. That amendment to saying removing sodium and placing LED fixtures.
Perfect. All right, all those in favor of the amendment say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Hearing none, the amendment passes. Now on the motion with the amendment, all those in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? Hearing none, the item passes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks
thank
for
you.
The conversation, everybody.
Wonderful.
All right.
Thank you, Jenny.
Let's go on to
District
the regular
five
agenda. let's go on now. Item number 9 is resolution of the CRA approving and authorizing CRA officials to execute a property improvement program grant with Whale Pond 2 LLC for on-site improvement.
Mayor.
Property located at 1909. Tyler Street. Yes, Board Member Biederman.
I'm going to step off the dais. Apparently, I have a conflict. I wasn't aware of the owner of the property.
Okay.
Or the applicant.
And just the nature of the conflict is what you might do pest control services?
We've done pest control services
okay.
for the owner.
Thanks. All right, so Back Board Member Biederman will abstain and will complete the proper forms. Let's turn it over now to Francisco.
Christopher. Christopher
Gushita. Keep getting Chris and Francisco mixed up.
No worries. Morning.
Sorry.
Chair, Vice Chair, Board members. As mentioned, we're here to talk about the property improvement program for 1909 Tyler Street. The property is located between Tyler and Polk on 19th Avenue. It's mm-hmm. the old Wells Fargo building. Mm-hmm. This is kind of the situation and the layout. And what I'm going to kind of dive into in just a second is the fact that this property in particular is the building, but it's a series of folios throughout the parking lot. This owner in particular, Whale Pond 2, owns these three folios. Folio number 1 makes up the majority of the building. Folio number 2 is part of the building and then crosses over into a north side of the parking lot. And then Whale Pond 2 also has that third folio. It's all owned by the same owner. This is just that particular to Whale Pond 2. It comes in importance when we talk about the breakdown or the scope of work that's going to be completed as part of this property improvement program. In front of us is just the series of items that are going to be redone or types of scope of work. This is the overall private contribution. It's about $2.9 million. And then what we do there, that if we were to approve the grant today, which they're eligible for three applications at $50,000 apiece, meaning $150,000, that's only 5% of their total contribution. Now, if we adjust their scopes of work to what is eligible within the grant confines, there's paving and grading, new pavers, taking the second floor of that bank building and then converting it into this event space. So, you know, there's a great deal of work that needs to be done to that entire roof structure. They're going to be doing new impact windows and doors, and they're doing kind of a food and event hall. All that older structural elements and the punch outs, they need to be kind of tied into new structural elements. So those things are added in there. If you adjust for what's eligible, that's about $600,000, where the adjusted percentage of the project would be $25,000 if the $150,000 grant was approved today. These are the existing conditions and some views from prominent areas within the downtown. You'll see what it looks like from 19th and Tyler. You see what it looks like from Tyler Street, also from Polk, and then what it looks like from the Circle. So it is a prominent building here in the downtown. And this is a view from the first floor looking up toward the northeast. So those punch outs that I was mentioning toward the bottom, those are going to be completely new. So tying in the structure for those is important and part of the scope of work. There's going to be some new signage and awnings and things of that nature and landscape throughout. that second story is going to look much like this. So it's a little bit different from what we see here in the top left picture. It's just kind of asphalt and roofing. This is what it'll look like. It'll be an event space. People can congregate, and there's landscape and planters and seating and awnings. And this is a view from Polk Street looking southeast. So where the current entrance is now, there's going to be a series of newer event spaces to the west. So these are kind of just some current views or current photos. At that bottom view, we'll show you where all the punch outs and its relationship to the street. So as mentioned, the total private investment is about $2.9 million with adjusting for eligible improvements, that's about $600,000. The CRA total contribution for the three folios would be about $150,000 at approximately 25% of the total project costs. You know, the total taxable value is $5.3 million with the resulting TIF after these improvements being about $38,000. And again, it's complete facade improvements, an interior build out to accommodate an event space, complete build out of the second story, and complete renovations that include impact windows and doors, awnings, and decorative architectural elements. And the CRA director recommends approval of this grant.
So I have a question on the board. I think I'm on the queue. He's in the thing. Is there a time frame as to when the construction will begin and when it will end, the improvements? Yep. You have okay. to come to the mic. Is the owner here?
Yes, the owner's here in the audience.
Hi, Jimmy Seda. We already started demolition. We have actively, you know, pursued our permit. It took a little longer than expected. We have our team in place, our contractors, our subs ready to go, and we're pushing through. We're business as usual. Of course, we would love to have some kind of help from the city.
When you for the grant, you mean yeah. itself. So when you say you're pushing through, so I just wanted to make sure that it's coordinated with all of the construction that's going on. Obviously, there's more to come, but trying to bring some type of normalcy back. So I'm glad to hear that you're starting that and going through. I just wanted to make sure that I have no problem. I'll make a motion to approve the grant. We're happy to see this building and this area be renovated. It looks the pictures look great.
Thank you.
We hope that it exceeds the pictures is our hope, or at least mine. And I just want to make sure that we have a time frame of completion set as well, so that when we do award the grant, obviously it's at the time of the end, correct?
Correct.
So whatever help we can with permitting and helping you out, I'm sure we have the connections provided, and we're wishing you the best, at least I am. So
Thank
I'll
you.
Make a motion to approve.
Thank you.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the item. Board Member Shuham?
Yeah, just first of all, thank you. It looks beautiful. Are you giving up any parking?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, this is strictly a renovation of the building. The building looks tired. Tyler yep. Street looks tired. Yep. We are carving out the retail on the first floor. There's a mezzanine floor that doesn't have glass. It's like a John Malkovich type floor. And we're going to give life to the building. We're doing an event space rather than looking for like a restaurant tenant. We're going to add staircases on the north and south elevation. You saw the decorative metal. I think we're going to add a center bar, which is very common on these rooftops. You know, and if you're having a bar mitzvah, you can come rent the space out. And on the ground floor, we already started leasing. I'm not current on what the occupants are, but there will be outside seating, and we're looking, you know, maybe trying to move the bus stop down the street, you know, getting it away from our south side front door.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Jimmy, just to add, welcome and good to see you.
Thank you, nice to see you.
I know you've been working on this for a long time. I see Joe Keeler, the architect here. As you know, as they've said, we're really looking forward to seeing this improvement, and I want to thank your family for the investment here.
Thank you.
We know you own a lot of property along Tyler and in different areas in downtown, and you're a big stakeholder, and we love to see this investment, and we hope to see more from you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
All right.
All right. All those in favor of item number 9, say aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion passes 6-0.
No, it's 9.
Doug, anything? Yep. All right. Next is item number 10, resolution of the CRA, approving and authorizing the CRA to execute a hotel improvement program grant with Reed Investment Corp for on-site improvements to the property located at 1711 South Surf Road in a grant not to exceed $63,000. Christopher.
Good morning. Again, Chris Crusader, project manager with the CRA, chair, vice chair, board members. So this is going to be a hotel improvement program for the Shoreview Hotel. This is down on the southern end of Surf Road. So you'll see here it's on Foxglove Terrace, abutting Surf Road. It sits right between Foxglove and Eucalyptus. The owners and the property manager are here in the audience. So the general scope of work, and right now you can kind of see the existing conditions. The idea is to fix any cracked stucco, paint the building, add a UV clear coat to the exterior of the building, because you'll see in some of the existing photos that the paint has faded over time. So adding that UV protective coat of paint will definitely keep that paint nice and bright. They're going to redo some of the staircase and corridor flooring in the courtyard. They're going to redo with new Spanish style tiles. They'll be doing new railings, a couple of impact windows and doors that need to be replaced so that the entire property is impact window, a new gate on the north side of the parking, and complete landscape throughout the exterior of the property, a roof fascia repair, and they're going to actually be doing some screening for the mechanical systems that's on the top of there, and then some pavers throughout that courtyard area. So the total project total amount is $189,000, with the 33% being roughly $63,000. So these are just some existing photos of what it looks like from Surf Road, from about Eucalyptus Terrace, and from the beach. So this is it roughly from Surf Road. You can see, like I mentioned, some of the paint is faded, and some of the trim elements definitely need to be painted and repointed and regrouted. And some of the landscape could use some updating. So this is that same view from Surf Road with some of the improvements as noted, the gate to the parking on the north, the pavers that are going to go in the south parking area, some new landscaping, the screening on the roof to accommodate screening for the mechanical system. This is the courtyard. So the tiles are pretty dated. They're pretty out of date. And some of them are cracked, so they'll be updated. Again, like you see the pavers that are going into the parking area, new railings, and a couple of those windows definitely need to be, were replaced for impact, and the screening and landscape. And then this will be the view from the beach. As you saw on the west facade, there's that Shoreview Hotel sign. They're actually going to be doing a complete new one on the east side so that you can see that that Shoreview sign from both sides. So as mentioned, the total private investment is about $189,000, with the 33% reimbursement being about $63,000, with the improvements being new paint, stucco, and that UV clear coat, new railings, refurbishing the west side sign, a new east side sign, pavers in the parking, some new windows, some screening for the mechanical systems. The property's taxable value is about $3.2 million, with the resulting TIF being about $2,400.
And we'll need to make sure that the sign facing the shoreline will be amber light if it's illuminated.
Correct.
Board Member McClary.
Actually, can you go back to the
photo of it? Sure.
So the lighting actually on the outside of the building on those will also be I didn't see it in the list, amber lighting. So you heard our discussion about the sea turtle friendly, and you were actually very, very close to the ocean. So we're hoping, and the sand, so we're hoping that all of the lighting, how can we get that in the before approval, make sure that it's all amber, the condition?
I think it would be appropriate to place a condition on it, but I just want to let you know that we intend to follow through.
So I'd rather it be in the contract before we approve than not.
Absolutely.
So just for clarity, they're not doing any kind of exterior lighting here, but I think what you're saying is what they currently have is amber.
So if they're not current, we want to put that in the condition so that mm-hmm. before funding is provided,
understood,
that the amber lighting is implemented so that we are doing our due diligence as the board.
Yeah. Susan, did you have something?
I was just to add that anytime any project that is east of the coastal construction line, when it goes through the City of Hollywood's permitting department, they make sure that all lighting has to be Marine Turtle friendly compliant.
So as we know, we have some non-compliance, right? So to be proficient, I think it needs to be in the contract.
Trust but
so
verify.
It is a checkbox. And that would be my condition to place with the approval.
Okay. Yeah, so when we do make a motion, let's include that condition that the building be made compliant with the Sea Turtle ordinance. As a condition of receipt of the funds. Let's go to Board Member Biederman.
Thank you. Can you go back to the resulting TIF? Because it seems very low considering the amount of investment that we are going to contribute. And normally, you know, it's on there because we've asked in the past about it. So, I mean, that's only my only concern is that the resulting TIF is minuscule compared to the investment that we're doing. And a lot of the ones we do, it's kind of a little bit closer in percentage.
Right. Well, this is just a rough estimate. I mean, obviously the ultimate evaluation will be up to the property appraiser, but we can certainly track it and make sure that the property appraiser is aware of the improvements that
will have been made.
The existing value, what do we have the existing value? Is it
3.2?
Yeah, taxable value is 3.2.
Okay. So that's the existing TIF, not the resulting TIF?
No.
Hopefully.
Yeah, I think that's the existing number.
Yeah, that might be the existing TIF. Okay. I'll update that.
And that's my only concern is that we try to get, I mean, the purpose of it is to bring up the taxable value and reinvest what they're paying into their own property.
Exactly.
So, and it's just not there. But, I mean, I get it that it needs to be done. I'm happy with the fact that we can, you know, kind of implore the mm-hmm. Sea Turtle lighting compliance stuff, and improve the aesthetics. But you know, it's a lot of money considering what we're getting back in return, or the CRA is getting back in return.
So, George, I'm really happy to see this hotel improvement program. We have a lot of small lodging hotels all over Central Beach and South mm-hmm. Hollywood Beach as well, and we know that. The more that they're reinvested in and preserved, to use a word, and made more storm resilient, like here with impact windows, and more aesthetically pleasing and mm-hmm. And improved, the more I think that'll bode well for you know the market, the small lodging market on the beach. Yeah. We all know this, and so that's you know one of the other reasons why we have this program. So I'm happy to see this. I hope to see a lot more mm-hmm. These small lodging. Yep. You know, hotels are what make Hollywood Beach unique.
Yep.
So let's continue to make them as charming as can be, because they really they really shine when they're you know maintained and invested in. So so let's. I'm happy to see this. Let's go to Board Member Shuham, and hopefully we'll have a motion.
I mean, I was going to say exactly what you did. This is just what we want to see. You know, people are very. Excited to preserve these low hotels to the best possible, so I think this program is being utilized. Mm-hmm. But I hear what Commissioner Biederman is saying. That delta is a little disappointing, but it's basically this is not much more than maintenance, assisting with maintenance, so it's not major changes to the property value from the property appraiser's office, but that would be great if you would encourage that. My only question is, whether this is in a historic district, and if so, will these improvements need to go to the Historic Preservation Board? And so, again, I think that we could handle it in the motion to approve, which Commissioner Clary, if you'd like to make it, subject
to... And you
want to
include the...
Yeah, just the lighting, and I don't know if anything needs to go to the HPD, but
HPP.
That would be in code anyway, and the process.
Right, that would be part of the permitting. But I don't believe it is historic or in a historic district.
Okay, I can't picture exactly, so go ahead.
So, can I go back?
Yeah, please.
Sorry. Go back to the picture one more time of the hotel. Okay. So, help me understand, George, or whomever. The windows inside the house are not going to have, inside the apartments, they're not going to have amber lighting. So they're going to have regular LED lighting inside. Isn't that glare also affected from the windows themselves onto the beach or no?
It can,
go ahead.
It can, but some impact windows do have that film on it that's kind of turtle friendly.
So how do we implement that as well?
That'd be part of a condition.
It's required.
I think the condition that you've already applied will take care of that.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. I just wanted to make sure we were covering all the bases because, you know, when they say they didn't know, it's a shame on us and also. So I will make a motion to approve with the sea turtle lighting approval, light fixtures and windows, you know, all sea turtle approval, along with making sure that it's not within the historical board, and if it is, it needs to go before the approval. Okay?
Second.
All right, we have a motion and a second on that motion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, the item carries unanimously.
Thank you for the investment.
Thank you.
All right. Let's go on to item number 11, presentation by the executive director regarding the CRA's social media workshop program for the beach and downtown businesses. George, did you want to continue this item?
I'd like to continue this item because it's been very successful, and we have another class coming up, I think, in a couple of weeks. And by the next meeting, we'll have even more information about the program to share with the board.
All right. So item 11 is just a presentation, so it'll come back.
Right.
Let's go on now to informational reports by the executive director on beach and downtown activities for the previous month.
So I'd like to give Christopher a short break and ask Francisco to come forward and give us an update.
I was feeling you before, you know.
So on the signage package, we presented an update at the last meeting. The board had several comments to make on particular signs. We wanted to continue the effort without delay, but we wanted to come back and report on those specific items that the board
And George, identified. We'll do our best to keep the discussion on these signs under 45 minutes, okay?
That would be wonderful. I'm sorry. Goodness. Francisco, if you would come forward and give the turtle lighting
first.
Update. Jeez. I'm sorry. Sorry, Christopher, I almost had you back up.
And we'll do our best to keep this one under 45 minutes as well.
Good morning, Chair, Vice Chair, Board members. Francisco Diaz, Project Manager with the Hollywood CRA. And today I have a quick update on the coating of the Broadwalk lighting. We currently have six light globes that have been approved, that have the approved manufacturer coating on them. These fixtures have been located in a strategic location right next to one of the big sea turtle nests within the Broadwalk. Three of them are located on one pole at Arthur Street. These are pictures of the front of the light pole just to show how the end product is going to look like. And these are some pictures of the same light pole from the back. As you can see, the coating will span not just along the back of the fixture, but also along the sides to avoid any light spilling onto the sandy beach. This is a picture of the same light pole from the beach right next to where the sea turtle nest is located at Arthur Street. Another three of the coated fixtures is located at Scott Street. It's also located right next to one of our a big sea turtle nest. And this is a picture of the same fixture overlooking at it from the beach. We already ordered 325 new globes, and they will arrive at the coating manufacturer by mid-July. Instead of waiting for all 325 gloves to be coated with the new proficient wildlife coating, and the manufacturer has agreed to coat 50 to 75 gloves per month so that we can start the replacement in mid-August. We anticipate to have all of the gloves replaced along the boardwalk by late fall this year. In the meantime, our CRA maintenance crew, it's removing some of the glove and applying two coats of black paint to protect the sea turtle nest. The first one got installed at Roosevelt Street. This is how the light bulb looks from the back. They're following the same methodology of applying the coat to the sides as well, so that there's no light spilling to the sandy beach. And this is photos from the beach. This light bulb was installed right in the center of two sea turtle nests. And here you can see the location from the two nests. The idea right now is for our CRA maintenance to coat at least one light bulb a day, so that we can install replace the light bulbs that are adjacent to a sea turtle nest in the next 2 to 3 weeks.
Thank you, Francisco, for that report. Is there a question on this report? Let's go to Board Member Biederman.
Yep, thank you. So the pictures were great. Next time, if we can, before we replace others, can we get before and after pictures at night so that we see the difference and how, you know, just for the public's purpose on the different view of before and after on a different, you know, lighting and stuff like that? I mean, that would, I think, be interesting to see.
Yep.
Okay.
But thank you very much. So what's the difference between the white and the black?
The black is our in-house coating.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the white one is going to be the actual manufacturer approved.
This is our quick and dirty.
That's what I thought. I just wanted to confirm it. Right. The other thing is, if we're buying 300 globes and then sending them to the company that's going to coat them, the manufacturer doesn't have a process to coat them in-house before they even leave.
Well, that's what he'll be doing.
It is 300 globes.
Yes, and we're buying some globes and we're replacing some because some of the globes don't survive the removal.
I understand that, but
right.
What I'm saying is, did we check with the manufacturer to see if they have a process in-house to coat them before they even leave so that we're not, it might be cheaper to just have them coat them, box them, and ship them out than it is to coat them, to box them, send them to somebody else to coat them, and then send them to us.
We did check with several globe manufacturers. They just don't have that capability to even come up with a product. I mean, they're just not set up for painting in their shops.
Okay. Thank you.
Vice Chair Gruber.
Just quickly, I think we can get a before and after picture if we go and take pictures of the ones that haven't been retrofitted, you know, even though it's not the same pole. If we could do that, and then
sure.
I had the privilege of going with Jenny on the beach last week, I didn't even know this existed, but there was this lens that you look through to see what the turtles are seeing.
Right.
Would it be possible to take pictures through a lens like that? I don't even know if it is possible.
It's the Jenny lens.
It's the Jenny lens. There it is.
It's like a red filter.
Well, I have to tell you, it's an amazing thing, and some of the stuff that we saw, like, you know, our businesses are trying to comply. Most of them are. Like, you go and you see, and they have red lights and amber. You're not going to go put red lights in your restaurant unless you don't know that you're supposed to try to do that. But some of them in looking, well, in, right. Some of them in looking through the lens, you know, there's this amber light, but it didn't work. It didn't matter that it was amber. In fact, we went to one place where they had heads, top hats that were red, the same exact light. And when I looked through it, two of them, you couldn't see anything, and two you could. And we walked up, and it was because the two bulbs were LED, and the other ones were not. So Very interesting. So there's a lot of education we could give towards our owners. There's a picture that I sent you of a restaurant that I'm going to show later that retrofitted their lighting with a rope LED that you change the color, and it went from blue to red, and you couldn't see any of that. But I don't know if that lens exists. I mean, it would be worth, with all the money we spend, to get a photographer.
We've looked into getting those. I don't want to jump in, but that's why I buzzed in just to say we looked because we thought this would be such a great Hollywood City giveaway, but it's like a lighting company. And I actually called them about a year ago and said, can we buy these cards from you? No. So.
But can we get, I'm not a photographer, but can a photographer take pictures
through that
with that on their lens? So, I mean, that's the way to see what's compliant, because we walked the beach and I saw amber lighting saying they're in compliance and they weren't, and then I saw lighting that didn't look like it was in compliance and they were. It's not, there's a lot out there. There's a lot out there. So I think if we could get a photographer to take pictures with those, that's the way to do it. That's my suggestion.
Thank you, Vice Mayor.
You're welcome.
Vice Chair. Board Member Shuhan, was that anything else, or did you say what you needed?
I just thought it would be such a great giveaway to all the businesses on the beach, and we tried.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you, Francisco, for that report. Jenny, we are making more progress on turtle lighting this year than in the city's history. So
I much appreciate it.
You got it. And thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for the advocacy. George, please continue.
Okay. Now it's time for Christopher and the signage update. So, Christopher, if you would come back up.
Let's start the clock on the 45
with us.
Minutes.
Yes. Yes. So again, we're just going to hit on those signs that the board, you know, had concerns about.
Good morning, Chair, Vice Chair, Board Members. Chris Crescido, Project Manager for the Hollywood CRA. Like George mentioned, we're going to go through the series of signs that you all wanted to kind of give some feedback on. Mason from Brooks Scarpa is here, so I'm just going to touch on some key points quickly, just so everyone is refreshed and understands that we're working with CMED and DCM to meet the same schedule that we brought to you guys in April, and then we're working in tandem with them so that everything can get out to bid for economy of scale and make sure that we can get a one signed contractor that will be able to build and fabricate and install all of the signs. So as mentioned, these are the four signs that you'll see today, the wayfinding, the gateway, and the destination signs. These were what was presented with some minor tweaks per updates that you all wanted to see. These are the locations of those specific signs, and we'll kind of delve into more detail, so this can be a little bit overwhelming, but for the most part, there's about eight wayfinding signs, four gateway signs, with one of the specialty signs being at Dania Beach Boulevard, and then four of the destination signs or park signs. So just to touch on, just a quick update, these are the materials that we'll be using. It's aluminum. Some of the signs have that same precast stone that we've been using throughout the Broadwalk. For continuity, we're also using the same brand standards colors that are that you see throughout Hollywood and within the logo. Everything matches the city's brand standards as far as logos, colors, texts, and things of that nature. So we mentioned this the last time. This is the gateway sign that you'll see at three locations. It's the Welcome to Hollywood with the yellow fin. The yellow was chosen to match the same style as the lifeguard towers, just to tie in and make all those connections. So the three signs that you'll see with that traditional, I guess you could say, gateway sign will be at Sheridan Street, Hollywood Boulevard, and Hallandale Beach Boulevard. And they'll be placed within medians strategically. The first one that we'll take a look at is at Dania Beach Boulevard. You all directed us to kind of, because we had the space, because a lot of the reason why we went with something that was tall was because there is an FDOT requirement that you need 4 feet off of the back of the curb on each side, which is why we can put them in medians, but it's more suited to a taller sign. Now the Dania Beach Boulevard, So as we come off of the, right before we get on the, the Sheridan Street Bridge within the swale. There's not a median there, so you'll see that it's put in the swale with some landscaping that accompanies it to kind of dress the area up. And then there's, I don't know why the clicker's not working. So in the median on Hollywood Boulevard, there's a patch area that's about 20 by 13 feet that fits and accommodates a sign of this size. So it can be put in the median so that it'll accommodate everyone that is going eastbound to the beach. And they'll see it right before they get off of the bridge. And then this is the Hallandale Beach Boulevard. This is right near the existing location, but the idea was to move it back slightly so that you actually were able to put it in the median, because if we were to put it in the existing location, which is just a few feet farther north, there's not enough space to accommodate that FDOT area that you would need for clearance. And then, as mentioned, the Dania Beach Boulevard, the idea was to take some elements of the sign that is at the downtown gateway sign and then add a couple of elements to it. So the actual Dania Beach Boulevard gateway sign will have these elements in them. Three shorter signs that have directionality to them, something that says welcome to, something that says thank you for visiting, and then the lettering that you see that's synonymous with the downtown sign. So these are the three elements, and that's what it'll look like. We'll incorporate that same letters on the poles with the beach down there near the ground cover, and then put some sort of landscape cabbage palms in the center of those three signs or three elements. It'll have solar lighting, excuse me, and that solar panel will be fit in and designed once we talk to the signage fabricator. They'll be able to tuck it somewhere where it's one more efficient, but also not, you know, taking anything away from the aesthetics of this sign. And then we have the wayfinding sign. This is similar to what is in the downtown. So the idea was to use the same style of sign with the, again, the same text and logo icons that are being used downtown so that we can direct people on A1A to different areas on the beach. So the historic Broadwalk, Hollywood Beach Theater, also known as the Bandshell, and public parking, most importantly, which is why we picked several of these locations in order to kind of direct people to public parking. They're all more or less laid out to key areas along A1A within the beach district. So there'll be one at Dania Beach Boulevard, right near where we saw that gateway sign. There'll be one at Sheridan Street right as you get off of the bridge. There'll be two on the northbound and the southbound side of the Nevada-Nebraska Street Garage, and then the same with the Garfield Street Garage. There's going to be one right at Johnson Street, and then there'll be one on Hollywood Boulevard, and then one at Jefferson. So we'll go through a couple of the southbound signs and then a couple of the northbound signs just so you can get an idea of what those will look like. So at the Nevada-Nebraska Garage, there'll be a sign just north of the garage entrance so that people are aware that they can park there. There is public parking, and then it'll guide them to the beach and the Broadwalk as well. And then the same thing with the Garfield Garage. You'll have right where the entrance is, you'll have a general, just north of where the entrance is, you'll have a general sign that gives you direction to where parking is, also the Broadwalk and the beach. And then the northbound signs will be located in specific locations. This one in particular is in the right-of-way just before Johnson Street, so it'll give people some idea of where parking, the Broadwalk, the water taxi, those sorts of things will be located. And then this one will be just south of the Nebraska Garage, so it'll give people, again, indication of public parking, the beach, and the Broadwalk. And then these are the concrete sleeved with the aluminum and the punched out letters and turtle. These are going to be the park and destination signs. So they'll be at Charnel Park, one at Johnson Street, one at Harry Berry Park, and one at Keating Park. So they'll be tucked in the right-of-way with some landscape around them. And, for instance, the landscape will go, and it'll have enough clearance and space so that the landscape kind of runs around the edge, the bottom edge, and there's enough clearance so that even if that grows tall, you're not blocking or impeding people from seeing the important thing that they're trying to see there. This will have the destination and something that indicates public parking. Same with the one at Keating Park. Thank you.
All right, it is 10:25. We do have an 11 o'clock, but certainly we're free to discuss for however long we want these signs. Let's begin with Board Member Biederman.
Seem to have a lot of questions today. Can you go back to the public parking signs?
Sure.
Because I have an issue with one of them.
Sure. Which one in particular?
Something that, go back one more. Right there. Stay there. Something that we come into issues with our residents is the misidentification of public parking versus city-owned public parking. And I don't know what we could do legally. And with the support of my colleagues, maybe the city attorney can look into other cities that might be having a similar issue. I know we try to address it with having a different logo than the private public parking. But this parking garage, while it's public, it's not the same rates as our garage. And if we're not advertising the privately owned public parking lots, why are we and I know it's a little different, why are we advertising the privately owned, publicly owned public parking garage over here?
I think on this one,
it'll just say
parking, right?
Yeah, correct. It'll just say parking on this one.
I don't know if you can see that on the...
And I know that the agreement with Margaritaville is that they try to mirror our prices as best they can and maintain their commitment to the bondholders.
Right.
And it's not always the same.
Right.
But even though I would like it to be, we need to treat everybody equally.
I think, you know,
what I'm saying?
On this particular sign, Christopher and I spoke about it yesterday, and I wanted to see just parking on it. Okay. We just didn't have a chance to update the graphic.
I think you'll see it there.
Oh, there we go.
Johnson Street will be a little bit different than those other destination signs.
Okay.
It'll just list out the areas that are there, so the historic Broadwalk, the Hollywood Beach Theater, and parking. So it won't say public parking. That one was just there for context of what
okay.
you saw last time.
Just
but understood.
Triggered yeah. you know, the comment.
Yeah, sure.
So can City Attorney, can you address whether or not, if there's support from the board, to see what other cities might be doing to identify public versus privately owned public?
We can look into that, but I do not see any reason why you would not be able to indicate that a lot is public or city owned.
But we can't.
You can't do that.
Part of the problem is forcing them to identify themselves as privately owned public parking.
Well, so we don't have to identify that. We're identifying what's publicly owned, and that we
can do. I know,
but
the typical consumer is not. It's not. It doesn't register with them. So I think that when a privately owned public lot is saying public parking, it is kind of false advertising a little bit. I don't know that, does everybody agree if the city attorney can see what other cities might be doing?
We'll look into it. I think
I know we
no
tried
issue.
It once before, but it's still a confusion thing for the public.
I think the main opportunity is probably if we could, in accordance with law, unless we're preempted, require particular signage on the privately owned parking lots to say, you know, it's a city-required sign, just like a required regulatory tow-away zone sign, that there would be a sign. It doesn't have to be unattractive, but it would say,
right.
like a disclosure, you know, warning, this is a privately operated,
right.
you know, lot that may boot your vehicle or whatever. But and that's,
I think we
that's
can't do that. We looked at that in the past. We can't require that on a private property. What we can, I believe, do is delineate that this is a city parking garage or a parking facility.
Okay.
So, Doug, if there could be a new memo on that,
yeah, we'll
point us to where that is. I know it's a business regulation, maybe therefore the problem, But let's put our heads together with staff and see if we can come up with something.
Some other city might have already come up with that, so I'm just, thank you.
Let's go to board member Shuham.
I had two questions. One was on the yellow fin sign.
Sure.
Yeah. Is it on both sides?
That was my question.
It's single-sided because it'll be in the median.
It seems like a real easy thing to make it two-sided, especially if it's in the median, because the ones that are in the middle like that, you can see coming and going.
But you would want the opposite side to say leaving instead of welcome to.
Well, you're coming. You're in Hollywood. In this location, you're coming and going to Hollywood. You're just not going to Hollywood Beach. So, yeah, you could say welcome to Hollywood on the other side.
We can look into that.
Go ahead. All right. Your mic.
If you don't mind, Commissioner, I'm sorry. If you were to put, you know how you have beach in the Dania one, this is entering into the beach, which say Hollywood Beach. At the bottom, you can put beach.
So it has the beach there on the horizontal.
This one says Hollywood, but I'm saying on the other side, so you say welcome to Hollywood.
Welcome to Hollywood.
Yeah. And, you know, in the other locations, I understand, you know, depending on the placement, if the back of the sign is against a fence, but
right.
In this location in particular, yeah. It seems like you should have something on both sides. So if you could just look at each of those fins.
Yeah. And go ahead, Jess.
We can definitely make them two-sided.
Okay.
Yeah. We've spoken to Brooke Scarpa, and we can do that.
And then the one at Dania Beach, which I'm very excited now to have something more elaborate there. But in that picture, on the back of that, are you saying that there's going to be the concrete signs behind it?
Yeah, here, I'll go to it.
But there'll be landscaping that we intend to put in so that basically what you'll see is landscaping. I think it was hard to really illustrate the concept.
Here's my only worry. I mean, one of the cool things about the letter signs is that it's you're looking through it. Mm-hmm. And so we're undermining that a little bit, you know? And then I'm also a little worried about staining on the inside of that concrete very quickly.
Okay.
I don't know if it's concrete. I just see those letters now in front of a rust-stained concrete wall. That's a worry I have. So without getting too crazy, could you just have the loose letters on all three sides, or would that just be visually too confusing? Like, why don't we just do the top one on all three sides?
I think that would look awfully busy because you're going to have all the spinning letters being... But it really depends on...
Okay, so then is there a way to make the letter one bigger so that it's spinning and visual from all three sides?
I mean, I if I might just add to the conversation here, I was a little apprehensive about the freestanding letters because of the difficulty in seeing them from different angles on the downtown welcome sign. So I was a little, you know, really concerned when I first heard from George that he was proposing these freestanding letters here. And I was thinking to myself, but the rendering doesn't look that bad. On the other hand, if we had, for example, a three-sided concrete thing, then it would really be uniform and tucked in and everything else. So even though, and I don't know how much more money, George, can you speak to how much more money the freestanding letters is versus one of these two-faced signs or one of these,
it's more,
you know, let's just call it the West signs?
I mean, if
it's way more money, I'm just throwing out to the board, we might want, even though this is pretty in the rendering, I don't know how successful it'll be in practice. So I
think what we might, it might make sense is to paint the back of the concrete signs, treat it so that, you know, even if it does get rust or whatever, we would come back and paint it, you know, periodically, so that it doesn't become just this afterthought.
Right.
You know, that would be part of the composition.
Well, where I thought you guys were coming back was actually across the street. So now I'm thinking the three-way concrete in that island, and then this sign across the street behind that white car when you come off there, that's really where I thought you were looking. And then it's like over the intercoastal.
Might be too much. honestly. I don't know. I like the idea of doing the three concrete faces. How much money would we save approximately if we were to do three of the white facing signs as opposed to the pole signs? Are the pole signs way more money, Susan?
I don't have the exact price, but they will be more money, maybe 25% more.
For the
ones that are on the poles, because of the structural calculations for them, they each have to have their own footer. So it's up to you, but if you want the three-sided concrete signs, that's obviously we can do that.
That's less expensive.
Right.
Correct.
Okay.
And we can
I'm actually fine with that.
Okay.
So we can...
Really, I really like the poles. I love the thing with the where you can see through the sign.
And we can also plant, like, as an example, we could put in Fakahatchee grass behind the pole sign so that that becomes, because Fakahatchee can grow to like 6 feet.
I would say you either do one or the other. To have both, it just is too confusing. So my concern would be that those poles, the upkeeping, the saltwater intrusion, and how efficient is it going to be? It's beautiful, and we all love it, but I just don't know with having both and the rusting and the elements, what would be practical, because we get those pictures of the breakdown and such. So either we just do the spinning Hollywood poles and get rid of the wall, that way it's spinning and everybody could see it from all different angles, or you do the three walls. But to have both, I think it's too much. That's just my opinion.
I agree. Either you just make that 3D Hollywood thing amazing right there and get rid of the other two, or you go with the three even.
That's just about it. It gets lost. See
I agree.
I love
maybe
that.
A consensus on that?
I mean, I'm just thinking, like, this is perfect.
I love
it. You have those two other signs there, and I'll give you a week before they're graffitied.
Yeah.
I love
this. And somebody's
this.
Out there to try and do it. But I like your hedge idea if we were going to go that way. But
right.
I think this is perfect, and we save some money.
I mean, this feels good. It's just unidirectional, just by the way. It'll only really be visible to people and be
readable.
So you
put an arrow.
I'm saying it'll only present itself to people coming around the bridge. It won't present it to people, you know,
leaving
with the other directions.
Can I just jump in?
Let's go to Vice Mayor.
One thing on this also. I'm 99% sure that where that little SUV in the upper right-hand corner is making a left, there's no stop sign there.
There's no stop sign.
No, I know. There's no stop sign. And then the other two spots going north and south do have a stop sign. So I don't think DOT would approve the other one. I think this is the only way to go because there's such a line of sight that we would block there with somebody coming off. I don't know if you've asked them already. Aside from the fact that I like this one better, but I use that road all the time when I go surfing Dania and whatever. So that would be very dangerous to put something that big.
I have
a good point.
I mean, to the mayor's point, when you're heading north on A1A and you're getting on to the bridge, you're not going to see anything.
Right.
So I don't know if it's too small to do this, but on that edge of the H, can you just put Hollywood, or is it too small, like on the exterior edge of that H, so that when you're coming, you would at least see a word? You know what I mean?
You mean to add like a fin, which kind of ties in the fins that we're using, and maybe attach that to the H?
Yeah, something so that it's visible.
I think she means more of a laser cut, you know,
laser
cut on the side, or the stuck-on letters that say Hollywood on the... Without going in the fin.
Yeah, and you could do it on the side of the D, too, just so that if you're leaving us, you're just not seeing a jumble of sculpture. You'd actually see the word Hollywood.
Like on both the...
Just on the edges of the letters.
And it would say Hollywood, but it would be facing...
Right.
Correct.
With the understanding that it's going to move a little bit. And the outside of the D.
On the outer edge of the H.
Right.
The side of it.
And the side of the D, I think that's a good point.
Mm-hmm.
Well, let me throw a wrinkle and just ask.
No wrinkles.
Right.
Right.
So if these are not illuminated, obviously, these are just going to be static.
I thought he said solar.
No, the solar is the lighting, but not the letters themselves are not, like, internally lit.
Right.
Right.
So it'll just be the solar lighting that you'll see from the ground.
So my point is that at night, since that's when lights are used, if you're lighting up a dark blue letter, it's going to be a lot more difficult to see than as if you were lighting up a yellow letter. Or a light colored yellow letter. because, you know, there's not going to be no glow to the letter with solar lighting if the letter is dark blue. So my question is, should we be looking at a different color for purposes of nighttime visibility?
Or can they treat the blue with something to make it pop?
Reflective? Yeah, we could maybe use a different colored light.
Could there be a reflective light? I mean, they make reflective like vinyl coating.
The material on the letter? I would think so.
That could be interesting.
Yeah.
Is as the headlights hit the light, it'll right. be reflective? Maybe that's cool.
That could be kind of cool.
Yeah. Maybe that could be cool. So I think the consensus seems to be that people like this the visibility through this pole sign, even though I was a little nervous about it. I like the way this rendering looks.
Mm-hmm.
It's still going to be less directional, but it is a nice entrance sign, no doubt.
Yeah, maybe the line underneath beach can have an arrow, so that people know it's still. I mean, even though the park is Hollywood also.
Yeah.
But just to identify, to the left is Hollywood.
Could you put beach? Yeah. The sign on that side.
You could an arrow on both sides.
I kind of like the right.
Do you have other perspectives of the concrete signs, just to give it a once-over?
Just of the concrete sign?
Just to see what...
Oh, just of the concrete sign. Well, we have these, but not laid out where you would see it on the other perspective.
So the only layout you have is the...
Yeah, that's correct.
Well, I think the line of sight issue that Vice Mayor Gruber pointed out is too important to overlook, even if we like the style of this better. So it seems like we have a consensus on the pole sign with a reflective coating. Preferably, or if you consider that issue, if you decide that maybe a different color, it should be a different color, then let us know.
We'll come back as we move forward. We'll come back to you with refinement, but we just want a consensus on moving forward. So we
and that includes the trees, the planting of those sable palms.
Absolutely,
right, what we saw in the rendering. Yeah,
let's get this ordered and in the ground.
Exactly, that's a great idea.
Susan,
what I think we would like to do is speak to the paint. Manufacturers and ask them what that looks like and get a sample and take it out at night and look at how that looks with lights, but that's what we'll work on.
So Susan, let me throw this at you. You know, in the world of wrapping cars, 3M makes obviously vinyl that lasts on a car. It could be that the wisest thing to do is just to basically, and it's easy to replace and maintain, is to rather than paint. As a reflective vinyl of vehicle wrap quality and put them on the sign faces here or just on the front facing of the Hollywood, and it'll reflect back to the extent that technology, you know, I know it exists. Metro Signs puts it on their Instagram and stuff, and that exists. They even have, like, glow in the dark.
To answer the question a little bit,
who are you?
Mason from Bush Scarpa. Nice to meet you. See you all again. To answer the question on the paint and the wraps, both could be done potentially. Paint would be more typical. It's a little bit easier to maintain in terms of touch-up if something went wrong, if there was a scratch, if there was graffiti. And then a lot of sign fabricators will kind of go with two processes. One would be the main one that we would want to use is an automotive paint, and we could use marine grades for locations like this that are near the water. But you think of some vehicles that have a kind of sparkle or a reflective kind of tint to them, like you were saying, for car wraps, that could be achieved with paint as well. We could ask or inquire about wrap rather than paint. But most fabricators that we've spoken to or worked with in the past would recommend paint over wrap for something like this that's going to be beat up and kind of weathered. You can do multiple layers and clear coats of paint.
It was just the question of the reflective versus color for visibility at night that we got into the conversation about wraps.
We can definitely look more into it, but just the base kind of line.
And if it was a wrap, in my mind, it's just the front-facing edge of the letter, not the all four sides of the letter. I do want to also just confirm, want to make sure we should do this all in aluminum and not in any steel.
Well, we all use, go ahead.
Yeah, so the sign bodies would be aluminum.
Right.
We would use stainless steel for hardware, and it would be tamper-proof.
Hardware, I'm talking about the pole. The pole itself
would
be an aluminum pole.
The box letters, that would be aluminum, right.
Right, I just want the pole to be aluminum so it doesn't rust quickly and last the ages. Board member Quintana, I neglected to call on you.
I tell you, in this group, if you want to say anything, you really do have to be aggressive.
I'm learning.
So actually, you talked about a lot of what I had wanted to talk about. I love Dana Beach sign. I mean, this looks great compared to what we saw the last time around. I think this is a huge improvement. When I do go to the beach, I often go to the state park in Hollywood, and I really enjoy spending time there. So I would want to make sure that people know that too is in Hollywood. The landscaping, I don't know if we already do it. Do we try to incorporate native plants as much as possible?
Sure.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Good. And then just the parking question, I had the same thought, Commissioner Biederman. In the short time I've been here, I've had calls from several residents who've suffered from confusion about private parking lots. And I'm just wondering if we already are doing anything to help educate people. Do we put stuff in print? Do we message visitors to Hollywood Beach about the option and the different rates that are available when it's public parking from the city?
Jovan from the parking department may know more about, you know, the effort that they are undertaking. But I can tell you historically, because a lot of these private lots tend to be kind of predatory. They want you to go in and park and then boot your car. And it's frankly a real challenge. And I just don't know what, if anything, they have been able to do to get that under control. We have not received many calls in our office as we used to, but Jovan may know more.
I'll bring it up with him. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's go to Board Member Anderson.
Do we have a picture where it's flipped around so we can see the badge? And also, I'd like to know.
Don't fall off that step.
Okay, we don't have an image of that.
The flat blue. I mean,
it'll be that flat blue, similar to the gateway sign. Same.
That's why I think we blue. Should put the Hollywood Beach right there.
She's saying double-sided on the beach.
Double-sided.
I agree. Yeah.
On that particular, that's a good idea.
Instead of putting it down, you could put down the side, but just put it right there.
Right.
Yeah. Double-sided on the beach sign.
As long as we place the landscaping so that it doesn't block the back of that element. Right.
Even if it does, it's just better to have it, I think.
Right.
Susan, as I'm looking at the letters themselves with the green behind them, again, a different color maybe make it pop more, like more contrast. I don't know if that dark blue is a good idea. So just chew on that if you could and let us know.
We can easily do a rendering with the yellow letters and see how that looks.
All right. Mm-hmm.
That's a quick.
Maybe a variety of colors so we can decide out of the color family that we have. Because look, in the turtle logo, there's a light blue.
An orange.
That?
And a yellow.
You see the light blue on the turtle logo?
Yes.
There's the sash over there. Maybe that's the color. So
we can come back with
five
different colors, but we just kind of want to go into production and the colors we can specify it.
Yeah. I like your idea of treating the sign face or the letter face different than the side of the letter. That could be interesting.
All right, well, show us some stuff, but otherwise we have a direction on the type of sign. That's a relief to you, I'm sure. Yes. Board Member Anderson, is that good? Let's go to Board Member Shuham.
Well, first, I think that's genius from Commissioner Anderson to put Hollywood Beach on the back of that, as long as we're there. And then to Commissioner Quintana's point, where I was pointing behind the white car across, maybe we could add one of those directional signs and identify the state park to the right, and then all those historic broadwalk, all those other things right there. So as people are coming off of Dania Beach Boulevard, they could look right or left.
Yeah, where is the directional sign?
Sorry,
you mentioned there was.
Give me one second. So there, that's right where you were saying behind that car. There's an existing sign there, but this can go in its place, and that'll be the directional sign, like you mentioned. That'll direct everyone further south toward A1A.
Instead of putting it here, which is when someone's heading south, we could turn it and put it right as I come off of Dania Beach Boulevard.
Okay. And you're thinking of putting it parallel to the road so you actually see it as you're coming off. Yeah. Yeah, I like that.
And add the state park to it.
Yeah.
So there is, I think, a state park sign on the right side as you approach that non-stop sign intersection, maybe on that right side, so people are making, they can say left to Hollywood Beach, right to the state park, and have the state park's name on our City of Hollywood sign. Maybe that might require some coordination, but just, I think you get the point.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
I call it MJ Park. MJ, like T-Y.
Really pretty, thank you.
Yep. All right, good. I think we have a consensus here and excited about the vibrancy that this will bring.
Thank you to all.
Vibrant signs.
Much appreciated.
So good stuff.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you, Chris.
George, anything else on the information report?
The last item is just to give the board a heads up. We're working on a resolution to increase the mosaic mural on the beach contribution from $10,000 to $25,000. It's appropriate that Elaine Hershey is here because at Billy's they're putting in a mosaic mural at the cost of which is upwards of $80,000.
Yeah.
And frankly, it's an element that we think makes a lot of sense on the beach. The one at Johnson Street looks today the way that it looked, you know, 6 years ago when it was first installed. And so mosaic is clearly the way to go, and it's a better incentive, we think.
Good, yeah.
Awesome.
Let's hope that we have
so we'll have the presentation at the next meeting.
Sure.
And that's it for the monthly report.
I want to welcome our city managers in the audience. Welcome, George. Good to see you. All right, so George is here because in 10 minutes we are supposed to start our joint special City Commission CRA meeting, talk about the transition plan, and then we have the City Commission meeting at 1 p.m. So if we could keep our comments as concise or waive them if need be to try to be as on time as possible, let's run through board member, general counsel, and executive director comments, if any, on the CRA. Let's go with board member Shuham.
I'll waive until later.
Board member Anderson.
I'll waive.
All right, we're on a roll. Board member Clary. Vice Chair Gruber.
Waive.
Board member Biederman.
Sure.
Board member Quintana, no pressure.
No problem. I have nothing to say right now.
All right. Waiving as well. General counsel. Waiving. Executive director. Any
just another 45 minutes.
Last
no.
words.
No, that's
last
it.
Rights.
That's it for that. I have nothing else.
All right. There being no further before us, business before us, this meeting is adjourned, and we'll see you back here at 11 a.m.